Zero for I Am Hip-Hop Magazine and GlobalFaction, and we are here with one of my favorite MCs, one of the dopest crews in the game and one of the dopest MCs to ever touch the mic, you know what I'm saying? So when you click into this, know that I'm coming from a real fan perspective. This is Vinnie Paz of Jedi Mind Tricks.
Thank you, brother, for the kind words. No, I appreciate the kind words, man. Thank you.
Sure, it's all honest, man, you know what I mean?
Thank you, man.
Like I said, I've been a fan from the beginning, man, from cool. Psychosocial.
Thank
you.
Man.
So
thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you on here.
Yeah,
you
know, it's a pleasure to be here with your brothers, yeah, man.
Appreciate it, bro. I guess for me, I want to sort of start from the beginning.
Sure.
When you came into the game, you came in sort of, you know, golden era.
Yeah.
You know, in that period, and you made your name.
Right.
Off the back of that era.
Yeah,
right?
of course.
So. That's a difficult task, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
to come
man.
Off these great MCs who were building this culture.
Of course. It was hard. Mm. Oh, go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, that's the question I was going to make. What was it like to do that and to how did you go about building that?
Well,
Stoop
and I met in 92 and started making demos. Mm. So, like, we were, think of all the shit we were up against in 92 and 93 and 94, like some of the greatest records ever made. You know, yeah. You had Cypress coming out, and, yeah. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, we were shopping demos. And we were getting, like, Stu being Puerto Rican and me being Italian. They're like, are you guys fucking crazy? Like, this shit isn't, you know? Like, it wasn't really a critique of the music as much as they couldn't see, well, how are we going to market this? You know what I'm saying? And then we got a meeting at, I'm sure y'all remember Rough House Records. Yeah, it was based out of Philly. And they had just signed Nas, and they signed him as Nasty Nas off the, they did the halftime 12-inch. And, they had signed Cypress, they had Crisscross, you know, so they were like popping. Mm-hmm. They had us up for a meeting, and I was only 15, so I couldn't legally sign anything, mm-hmm. you know, without my mom's permission or whatever. So they offered us like the worst deal in like the history of music. It was like, they said the word $250,000. And to me, being poor, bro, that was the prank. I was like, wait. $250,000? But it was a 10 album deal. So realistically, I might have just been getting out of it like now.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So because of my age and shit, I didn't sign that. And then, do you remember Blunt TVT? They put out the Mike Geronimo shit.
They
had us up for a meeting. But again, it was more like some labels were trying to like sort of be like, well, you're Italian, like we can make you like a mafia guy, like so, you know, some weird shit. So it was like either bad deals or rejection. So mm-hmm. then we were like, well, should we try to do this ourselves?
Mm-hmm.
So we were called Soulcraft before we were called Jedi Mind Tricks. So we did like a professional cassette mm-hmm. in Philly and sold it, saved up the money from that for the next shit. And then we changed it to Jedi Mind Tricks. Mm-hmm. And that started that. And that was 96. And it was like we were coming up in that independent boom of mm-hmm. like, nonfiction and raucous mm-hmm. and all of that, you know what I mean? So it was like, it was, I was surrounded by so many talented people. There's like, there's two ways to take that. Like, mm-hmm. this is competition and I dislike them, or this is healthy competition and they're helping me get better because mm-hmm. I want my darts to be, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's good.
Sure.
And I'm still friends with a lot of those dudes from then, you know? So sorry if it wasn't a direct answer, but coming from them was like, I was just influenced by the best shit, you know, like the greatest era ever being from like, you know, 86 to 94 or something, or 86 to 96 is when I was, that's when I was shaped, you know what I'm saying? Like,
so
I'm just lucky my parents decided to have me when they did. That's just luck, man. It's dumb luck, you know? It's dumb luck.
No, but I mean, there's the element of being born at the right time, but then you surrounded yourself, as you said, you surrounded yourself with the right people.
I think that's important, man. I think delusional people think they're the best and they feel that they should surround themselves by yes men.
Mm.
And then they sort of create this own delusional world of themselves where no one's saying like, you could do better or maybe you should do this. But I was never opposed to that. You know what I'm saying? I wanted Stoop to be like, no, you could do better. Or, you could say a better rhyme there. I'm still like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think when you believe you're the best, where is that to go? Mm-hmm. You believe that, you know what I'm saying? It's like, no, I could be better. Mm-hmm. I could do better. I could do better for other people. I could help more people. I could, you know what I mean? It's like, you should always try to be better than the day before and everything. You know what I mean?
And that's, it's hearing you say that for me, you can hear that in the rhythm.
Thank you.
Because thanks. I mean, it's been said before, but you have this clear change between the psychosocial,
of course,
and Violent by Design, right?
Of course.
Not just the voice, but like even the content switched up, and I think the intricate lyricism is obviously always been there and remained there. But on the psychosocial, there's this the esoteric information in there, and then with Violent by Design, which is my favorite album.
Thank you, man.
I love that album. You have this balance between the raw street shit, and that same esoteric knowledge.
Well, let me tell you something about psychosocial, because it might be the dumbest move in the history of rap music. It's like, all of our favorite artists, maybe some of them have like a concept album. Mm. Maybe it's their fifth album. I was dumb enough to think that a fucking esoteric concept album should be the first thing. So everyone heard this crazy album that was just influenced by bizarre things and drug use and crazy shit. And I didn't realize, oh fuck, this is going to be people's first impression of me. Am I ever going to be able to dig myself out of this hole? Mm. Not that it was a terrible hole, but just, oh, this is what he is. Or this is what they are, you know what I mean? And I felt like historically that was like maybe a bit of a mistake to debut with that, because it was so out of, down the, like off the beaten path.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So now that I look back, because I was like only 18 or 19, the grown me would have never done that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I would have been like, reversed it. Like, yo, let me do, the shit I was doing at the time was rhyming on the corner and battling and shit. So that's how Violent by Design sounded. Yeah. So maybe I should have come up with that first. You know what I mean? But, shit happens. You learn. You live and you learn. That's how I see it.
And I think you're still getting fans from that album. You know what I mean?
Like a
throwback.
Sure, no, I have young kids hit me up about it all the time. So it's like, it's just strange to think of how I did that. I don't know. Someone should have stopped me. You know what I mean? But no one did.
It worked, man. And it worked. And like you said, you managed to, I don't even want to say save it, but you made this transition to that more street shit, right? By Design. And it's, like I said, that album is incredible. It's an incredible album. Right?
I appreciate
it. I feel like something must have been happening at the time for that album to have been created.
When you hear about like any albums historically, it could be the Beatles, it could be the Animals. It's like, I don't know. There was just like some weird energy going on at that time. Like weird shit would happen with Stoop and I. We'd be like eating pizza and hear a song on the radio that somehow connected to something we had just did. And we were like, yo, this is all, the universe was, shit was just falling into place, you know what I mean? We were recording it in a bedroom, man, it wasn't even a studio mic. Mm-hmm. It was a mic that you use on stage.
Okay, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, everything technically should have been wrong. Everything we were doing, our machine was half broken, the ADAT was half broken, like, everything about it was wrong. The acoustics in the bedroom we were recording in were terrible, nothing was logical or rational about it. We didn't even master it, bro. We mixed it in a bedroom and sent it to the pressing plant. It was crazy.
But it worked, and I think it's that rawness, maybe.
I agree.
That makes it,
But we didn't know that.
For real.
We were just doing what we could, trying to make chicken salad out of chicken shit.
Coming from Philly.
Yeah.
Was there any? I mean, again, I've never been to Philly, but it has a rich history of music,
right? Sure,
especially
yeah.
hip hop. It has like the roots, and a lot of other people who come up.
Schoolie D and Cool C and Steady B and Tough Crew, like that shit. Those guys were like Marvin Gaye to me. You know what I mean? And then we had, like Kenny Gamble and Gamble and Huff, and Philly Soul So it was. The thing is, though, man, like being 90 miles from New York, you know what I'm saying? It's like we were the bastard son.
That's what I was gonna ask. Was there any kind of resistance you had?
Absolutely.
Punch walls down and shit.
To this day, I will tell you that we would have been more known quicker if we were from New York. Mm-hmm. It was like just constant resistance because it's a very insulated culture in New York. It's like you have LA and you have New York, and they're insulated cultures.
Yeah.
And if you're not part of those, it's like you spend as much time trying to kick down the door as you do trying to create. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, but I was, at that point in my life, I wasn't taking no. Mm-hmm. I was like, no, I'll just go up there and rhyme and win that way. You know what I mean?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, but it was like, you know, it still like looked as like the little brother of New York or something, you know? Mm-hmm.
Is that something that's improved your technique and improved your work ethic? Because that's the thing as well, you're prolific.
It's probably made me more have a chip on my shoulder.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know if it directly influenced being prolific or anything. I don't know how it did. It's hard to say. It's like, when you talk about how your parents influence, sometimes you don't know and sometimes you can directly say.
Yeah.
But it's like I knew Tariq and Amir from The Roots since I was a little kid. So when they got their deal, that changed everything in my head.
Yeah.
Because there was a gap, bro. Like you had 86, 87, 88. It was like Schoolie D, Cool C, Steady B, Tough Crew. And then after Will and Jeff blew up, there was that long gap, bro.
Yeah.
Like, but until The Roots came, where nothing was coming out of Philly and no one was touching us from major labels. And then, like, when I saw them and they told me, oh, we got a deal with Geffen, I was like, oh, shit. You know, and then that took a little time. And then once Jay came in and, like, swooped everyone out of Philly, like State Property and Beans and Freeway, everything shifted, you know what I mean? Then everyone was coming. And then it got oversaturated.
Yeah. Because
they were signing too many people. You know what I mean? If you were from Philly for a certain period of time, you were getting a deal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it works both ways, man. Mm-hmm. It's like the cream rises to the top. That's for the sure. Bottom line. You know?
For sure. Yeah. And just to go back to this idea of your work ethic, because like I said, you are prolific. The amount of albums you've done as JMT and then Army of the Pharaohs,
right.
Solo projects.
Right.
How important is that work ethic to you? If you were to recommend, you know, speak to younger MCs who are coming up, how important is it to put in that level of work? And also, How do you keep the content coming for that period of time and it still be fire?
It's sometimes like if it's your father or uncle that like goes to work 7 days a week and you can't understand, like, yo, this guy's working 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. And if you really ask him, it's because he loves it. I still love it.
Mm.
So my work, to use the word work, my father used to say it's not work if you love it.
Right.
So it's like, can I call it work ethic when I love the craft? I love, I'm most at home writing and being in the studio. You know what I mean? Touring is when I get to meet brothers like y'all. And it's like an honor and a privilege to meet people 5,000 miles away that you share so much in common with. But, you know, the craft, it's not work for me. I have to be in the studio every week. So I don't know that I could give someone a tip to work hard. Well, you can say that to anyone. Motherfuckers is lazy, they're gonna be lazy. Me telling them to work hard isn't gonna change that. You know what I'm saying? When I hated math in school, so you could have told me to work hard at it, but I hated it and I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I wasn't good at it. It couldn't click. Yeah. I'm left-brained.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know what I mean? It's like, and the fact of the matter is, it's not. Some, maybe there's an exception to the rule, but most people, yo, if you whack, you can work as hard as you want. You're gonna be whack.
Yeah, for sure.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
I don't mean to be negative, but some people have improved. You go, yo, this guy got real ill from this record to this record, but it's few and far between.
Yeah.
Most of the time, it's like, yo, some people are wasting everybody's time, man. You were there for the boom in hip hop. Like, we were part of a subculture 20 years ago, 25 years ago. It was subculture. You know, now it's globalized. McDonald's commercials have a DJ. So now everyone thinks they can do it because if they have a laptop and a mic, you could do an album. We come from an era where you had to really work and save money and maybe steal. Like, I had to do some shit I wasn't proud of. Like, you know, sell weed or steal jackets, starter jackets.
So what are you going to do, man?
Yeah, I'm not proud of it, but you had to do it for studio money.
Yeah.
That's dead now. So our culture is being controlled by a fast food mentality. I mean, anyone can do this.
Yeah.
It's why you see the fall off of the quality, you know what I mean, in certain areas, you know?
And what do you make of the of this era we're in now, this, you know, the mumble rap and these kinds of things? Because as a lyricist, a real lyricist, do you feel like the craft is being harmed by this?
Well, I'm a believer in like everything happens for a reason. Like, if me and you go to a strip club, do we want to hear Pharoah Monch? I'm just like, there's a time and a place, dude. I don't think certain adventure movies are good cinematic experiences, but some shit's blowing up and I might watch it and it serves its purpose. Right. But if I want to watch some shit, it's Kubrick. Mm-hmm. So it's like, to me, there's a time and place. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's just how I see it. It's not something that I feel like it started as a subculture, and if the lyricism reverts back to that, then cool, it'll still be there. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like, what people forget, bro, like, people forget that Hammer and Vanilla Ice dominated the airwaves. People forget that CNC Music Factory dominated the airwaves. Mm-hmm. Is that really any different than, you know, it sounds different maybe, but it's still pop music. Mm-hmm. It's like, when you had to go and find EPMD.
For real.
So yeah. If you want, you know, it's no different than finding good food. Like, mm-hmm. McDonald's is mad easy to find, and you go find some good shit, we gotta look.
For real.
So that's how I see, you know.
I feel you, bro. I feel you. We're short for time, right? So I'll just get you one last question.
Sure.
Just with the because another aspect I love about your music, you have the road shit, you have this wisdom, and then you have the political element, right?
Yeah.
So with all the madness that's going on in America and around the world at the moment, how does that influence your thinking at the moment, and what would be your view on ways people could go about maybe changing this or influencing
the
situation?
Well, for the first time in my life, my knee-jerk reaction was like, yo, I'm ignoring all of this. I wanted to pretend like it was a bad dream. Mm-hmm. Like, this cannot be possible. Mm-hmm. What is happening? But you can only think like that for so long until you start worrying about. And it affects me differently because of what I do for a living and travel the world. Mm-hmm. I don't just have to think about this maniac running the United States. I have to think about what he might do here, mm-hmm. what he might do in London, mm-hmm. how it might affect here, how it might affect people that I know in South America or in Syria. I have, you know, like Muslim brothers that are in Syria right now, and he's mm-hmm. dropping bombs. Mm-hmm. So it's like, it affects me differently because I have to think about like, yo, I might lose somebody mm-hmm. because of this. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But it's like, yo, man, we don't work for the government. They work mm-hmm. for us. Historically speaking, it's like, if people really want to get down and overthrow some shit, mm-hmm. we have the power. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That mm-hmm. like, sit back and let shit happen shit, like that didn't happen when Malcolm was here and Martin was here, you know what I mean? So the question becomes, where are they? Mm-hmm. Who's gonna step up and do some shit that Gandhi did, or do some shit that Malcolm and Martin did? Mm-hmm. Where are they? Who's gonna do it? You know what I mean? I don't know. We need them.
For real.
Yeah.
For real. Well, bro, we done for time, right? But yo,
my man,
pleasure to meet you.
Thank you, man.
Kill the show tonight.
Pleasure, man. Enjoy it.
Hey, man. Respect.
My man.